If you don't believe that God has got his hands on this company, there's something wrong with you. Hey, folks, and welcome to another edition of BTP Sports Talk Sideline to Sideline. I am your host, Mitchell Brock. And joining me on the panel today, to my right, rejoining us, the Tennessee Volunteer himself, Mr. Damian Jolivet. Don't ever do that.
Tried something new, man.
I know what we're going to screen cap and post pro for this week's show.
Oh, man.
And to my left, Laredo's finest. Around these parts, we call him Riley Cooper, the one and only. Mike Tula.
I'm keeping it stoic for this one.
So. There you go. So, the first thing we want to talk about today is, it's no secret I'm a Michigan fan here, but even if I weren't, no matter what major university this would have been, with all that's going on, I would have wanted to talk about it. The Michigan football program is in a state of turmoil right now. Mm. Got the new coach in Jim Harbaugh. Okay, now, and another thing I want to bring up real quickly is, as I was finalizing my notes this morning for the show, I looked up Michigan football and I saw that recruiting coordinator Chris Singletary is now out of the program. Y'all probably don't know who that was, but I do because he was a high school teammate of mine. He played at Michigan, was on the 97 championship team, got hired right out of school, and he's been started off as a recruiter and a scout, then he got up to scouting coordinator. And I read an article this morning that said that he's no longer with the program. Mm-hmm. So, Chris, just wanted to let you know, we got your back, whatever's going on. And I tell you what, you'll find a job somewhere else, my man. So, we want to get off into the state of Michigan football. Starting corner / slot man, Dennis Norfleet, has come up academically ineligible, which is not a big thing at Michigan. You don't hear that too often about major players coming up ineligible. Of course, other players, you might not even hear about it.
Right.
You know, four, including Norfleet, have left the program. Starting center Jack Miller, quote unquote, retired, going into his senior year, just said he didn't want to play football no more. That was the first one. So we're like, okay, big deal. He don't want to play no more. And then Blake Countess, who was tied for the Big Ten lead in interceptions last year, graduated and said, I got one more year of eligibility. I want to play somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So now we're like, okay, wait a minute, what's going on? And then two other players, offensive lineman Kyle Bosch and running back Justice Hayes, who was competing for the starting running back job, all walked away from the program. Hmm. Jolivet, Jim Harbaugh has come on the scene and is really, really running guys off. You played in a major program. Talk to me about the grind of a major program, especially with a guy like Jim Harbaugh.
Well, anytime you have a new coach coming in and setting new standards, mm-hmm. and you are a part of the old coach who you were recruited by, you tend to have problems and you clash. Mm-hmm. And so because we all know that Jim Harbaugh is a no BS guy, you're gonna do it his way. And if you don't like it, go to your mammy.
That's right.
And now that he's changing that culture around Michigan, mm-hmm. which is what you have longed for.
Yes.
And what's that coach name, the last coach?
Brady Joke.
Yeah, Brady joke. He had a whole bunch of pacified babies, mm-hmm. and now it's actually being shown because now they can't handle the pressure of doing things the way Coach Harbaugh wants to do it.
That's right.
I don't care who it is. Mm-hmm. Every last one of those players want to play on Sunday. If you go to a school like Michigan, mm-hmm. Ohio State, I know I struck a nerve, Tennessee, Alabama, Florida, you know, you want to play on Sundays at some point in time. But if you don't want to play on Sundays, then by all means, don't want to play on Sundays. But, hey, I need you to be prepared for Saturday.
Exactly.
Now, Brady Hoke, you got these pacified babies in there, and they were pacified about everything, and now you got Jim Harbaugh coming in there changing stuff up. Hey, look, they don't need them no way because they're going to be soft, and those are going to be the ones that quit on you on Saturday.
That's right. Now, I probably know a little bit more about the culture of Michigan football, I would say that the goal of most Michigan football players is just to win. It's the tradition. Mm-hmm. It's the winged helmet. It's the running out of the tunnel and touching the gold blue banner. Mm-hmm. It's the hail to the victors. That it used to be a time.
You back in week 12.
That's right. Exactly. The goal at Michigan has always been, especially back in the day, we didn't care about national championships. All we wanted to do was beat Notre Dame, beat Ohio, win the Rose Bowl. That's it. You know, so playing on Sundays is kind of like a bonus, kind of like gravy mm-hmm. at Michigan. It's just they want to carry on the tradition of the Big Block M. Now, Tula, let's talk about some violations. I know you like to talk about minor violations. I always love your opinion on them because you get the best opinions on minor violations. There were four self-reported violations with U of M football, and the number one was they discussed a recruit publicly who they had not yet signed. I didn't know that was a violation. Apparently they didn't either. This one, it really kind of struck a nerve with me because they were actually doing a good thing. They donated a signed helmet and jersey to a high school scholarship fundraiser. I mean, come on, they're trying to help a high school out. You know, apparently is a violation. They provided online recruiting links to a recruit, or material to a recruit via social media, which apparently, again, is apparently a violation. And this is another one that was, I laughed at this one. They allowed a recruit to sit in a premium seat at, you can't even say it with a straight face.
No.
They allowed a recruit to sit in a premium seat at a U of M hockey game.
Okay, how many people go to a hockey game in Michigan?
Oh, don't get it twisted.
That's a lot, no?
Okay. Michigan hockey is a half a step under the football program.
Okay.
But, you know, college hockey in general don't really get.
Yeah, don't get that
blow. Yeah, but, yeah, Michigan football, hockey, and softball are all, like, you know, together. But apparently you can let them sit in a seat but not a premium seat.
Got a big club level, right?
Apparently, right. What do you think about that?
I mean, it's not a big deal to me, especially, you know, they're donating to a scholarship. Harbaugh put on his Twitter, actually, Oscar Wilde, he quoted him, "No good deed goes unpunished."
Mm-hmm.
And apparently, University of Michigan doesn't think these are big deals anyway, either, because, you know, they reporting them themselves.
Yep.
So the repercussions probably aren't going to be that big a deal.
Right.
And rightfully so. I mean, this is really,
Right.
We already talked about, we're going to talk about the competitiveness of the game, affecting the outcomes of the game. This is just par for the course when it comes to recruiting. Recruiting's a dirty game.
Right. And like I told you guys before we started rolling, you know, when I decided to do this segment, each one of these issues are not that big within themselves, but all of it rolled together going on at the same time is like, man, what is going on with Michigan football?
Right.
Now, we have joining us remotely from her office our own resident NCAA rules guru. She don't like when I say that, but that's why I keep saying it. Miss Leah Frazier. Leah, you there?
I'm here, guys. Hey.
Okay. So you were listening, and you heard
us
talk about those violations. And most times, like when you and I worked the one night of the NCAA South Regional Basketball together.
Yes.
And you just, with those rules, you're on it. Talk to me about those four violations that I just mentioned.
Okay, so let's go by them one by one. What's the first that you, the first rules violation?
They discussed a recruit publicly who they had not yet signed.
Okay, yeah, that's a big no-no. A university cannot discuss a recruit by name before they have actually signed with the university, and that's across the board with all Division I sports. And so I cannot believe that the university slipped in, especially a big-time university like Michigan. And so that you absolutely cannot do that. And the repercussions behind that could be jeopardizing actually the student-athlete itself, their eligibility to compete.
Okay. And you just actually brought up a very good point. I'm like, oh, I didn't know that was a violation. You said Division I football. I played Division II ball.
Okay.
So that's probably why a lot of these things I had no idea were such major violations. I mean, D2 ball is still NCAA, but, you know, they're not as stringent. The second one was they donated a signed helmet and jersey to a high school football fundraiser for a scholarship fund. What do you know about that as far as violations go?
Okay, well, there's a lot of gray area here, that some things that maybe we don't know behind the scenes, but a lot of it will depend on who the helmet actually came from. If you're giving something away, the monetary value of that has something to do with it as well. A lot of times it's a lot easier for the university to purchase an item that they then are going to give to an organization for them to give away. And so, you know, again, and you said it was autographed, correct?
Yeah, autographed jersey.
And then who is it autographed by is kind of something as well. If it's an alumni, if it's an active player, those are things that it becomes very gray, and we don't know all of those details. And so if they violated something, it's probably because the item was not purchased. It probably was something of greater value than they would actually get it being given away to the organization. Okay. And the money that they'll earn from the, you know, the raffle or lottery or whatever, however they're going.
So it's more of a value thing.
It's more of a value thing. But unfortunately, because I don't know enough of why it was a violation, I really can't speak specifically on why it was, but I could guarantee that a lot of it has to do with the value of the actual item.
Okay.
Well, no wonder it wasn't a violation, because it's the University of Michigan.
Oh, here we go.
I had to take that one in.
Really? Who's your college team?
Next question.
Exactly. Mm. Exactly. So we've got about a minute left in this segment. So we'll blow through these next two. They provided online recruiting material to a recruit via social media. I can kind of see that one. I see that one. You know, it's kind of like giving them the playbook, so to speak, and they haven't signed him yet. So I kind of see that one. Real quickly, they allowed a recruit to sit in a premium seat at a hockey game. Like Tula said, apparently the recruits are, you know, way up somewhere, but apparently that's a violation. So all I know is that, like Joe Levette and I were talking about before the cameras rolled, I'm glad that they finally got somebody in the program that's gonna get these guys straight. We look forward to when they come to do their camp here on June the 8th here in Houston. We'll be there with bells on. So, but we got to take a break. So we'll be right back after this break.
You know, and I'm so happy to be able to be hanging out right now with Dr. Sabrina Jackson, who is the mother of Marcel Smith. And thank you so much for hanging out today.
Thank you so much for coming out today. We are so excited about this book and what Marcel is making happen in the world. So I am just beaming with pride today.
Oh, I'm sure you are, because, you know, as moms, sports moms, that's what we do, is we beam with pride. Because we know that after we have had to, you know, sometimes put our foot down on some of
the neck. Put it in the neck. Yeah. Put in the neck.
Yes, you took the words right out of my mouth. I was trying to decide, do I want to be politically correct on here?
And just gonna be, you know, real. We bring in the pain.
We definitely bring in the pain. So I love you. So and we love Marcel. Marcel,
yes,
is going to making us
where
he's making us proud as, yes, as mothers of scholar athletes.
Yes. Yes.
Being able to, from his perspective, share what's important. Because, you know, so often, you know, we could have wrote a book. You know, neither one of us could have wrote a book about what they should do, mm-hmm, as scholar athletes.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think what's so powerful is that once you go through a thing, then you can relate and you've real life lessons that you have gone through so that the other person doesn't have to reinvent the wheel. So to me, your test becomes your testimony. And so that's just what this book is. And so as I was reading it, because he wrote it all without me reading it, he didn't send it to me until it was done.
Okay, because, you know, I surely would have been like, if I knew my mom was an author, I'd be like, ooh, mom, can you check this out?
He would not let me see it. He didn't want my viewpoint on it. It was definitely all from him. And that's what, you know, as we prayed this morning, because, you know, today is the National Day of Prayer. As we prayed this morning, we talked about how the Holy Spirit is just in control. And because the Holy Spirit is in control, whatever, because he was saying in the prayer, it doesn't matter about the money, it don't matter about how many people come, just that people are impacted and their lives can be transformed. And there's so many young people who get the sports right, but they get the academics all wrong. Or they get the academics right and they can't seem to get the sports right. So when you have the balance, you can do it all.
You really, really can. And you know, kids like, or young adults like Marcel, they're wired in that way. And so you really, all we can do as parents is help guide it, because exactly, they're really gonna do what they need to do, because that's just how they're wired. And you know, that's what we, I think that's how we connected initially too, because we understand that type of mindset in our kids.
Absolutely. And it's so important as parents that we don't try to make them be who we think they should be. We should discover what their passion is, but then use it to our benefit.
Oh, okay. Most definitely, because I'm just saying, we need you to earn your own money.
Yes.
So you can, exactly. And I'm okay with even buying your own house, but I have my own room with my own bathroom and like my own wing. I'm good with that too.
Own wing. I can do my own wing. Yes. So by the balance, I'm looking for a wing to a house.
With my sister girl, Dr. Sabrina Jackson, this is Coach Leah.
And now joining us on the panel, we got the champ in the house, the one and only Mr. Ricky Jackson.
There he is.
Pretty Ricky, what they call him. So, okay, Y'all know when y'all see the champ, it's time to talk about some boxing. All right, so the first thing we want to get off into is the fight between Mr. Saul Canelo Alvarez and Kirkland last week here in Houston at Minute Maid Park. Champ, talk to me about that fight.
Well, I think I indicated that Kirkland minus Wolf means no win. I mean, and that's for a variety of reasons. I mean, she had the handle on Kirkland to keep him in control, make him behave, make him get ready for his fights, and keep him in the process of boxing to be successful.
Right.
You know, that was his second loss, and that was his second time without Ann Wolf. Mm-hmm. You know, so, I mean, the thing about Kirkland is he's a guy that has issues. You know, he has trouble outside the ring, and boxing is a sport about discipline. If you don't have that discipline to stay focused on the process, of course you're gonna fail at it. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, he went out there and tried to jump on Alvarez and shoot his best shot, but when he, as they say, shot his wad, game over, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it'd probably be the fight with the knockout of the year.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he got destroyed after the first round, you know? And listening to Ann Wolf after that fight, she had sympathy for him. Maybe not his performance, but she had sympathy for him. Mm-hmm. I understand how that goes with, you know, you have a relationship with a fighter for X amount of years, X amount of fights, so that becomes family.
Right.
So, you know, to see them get destroyed like that and know what goes on behind the scenes, she was sympathetic to it. And I can appreciate that. You know, but, you know, this is big time boxing,
it
right?
Is.
You know, this is as good as the game gets, and he stepped out there, I think, half-cocked, you know, with issues outside the ring, and it cost him dearly.
Yeah.
You know, he got destroyed after the
he
first
did.
Round.
I don't even know the brother.
Yeah.
I was sympathetic toward him. I wanted to go help him up.
But the sad thing about this is it really could have been a good fight,
mm-hmm,
if he had prepared properly and kept his house in order. Mm-hmm. And it would have been had the potential to be the fight of the year if it had been brought together correctly. So unfortunate for him, unfortunate for the boxing fans. You know, it turned out to be just what was expected, which was him go out there and get pretty much handled by Alvarez. So
now, the first round was actually a pretty good round.
That was it.
Yeah.
But it ended right there for him.
Exactly. Yeah. He like you said, I think he went out too hard, too fast, and he ran out of gas. That's what I saw too.
Yeah.
What you think?
Well, it really was over at the first round. And
yeah.
After this fight was over, I couldn't help but think to myself that his corner did him a disservice by not stopping the fight sooner, especially the referee, because mm-hmm. you knew after that first round, it was over. I mean, Kirkland, his legs were a little jelly. Mm-hmm. He was pushing his punches as opposed to, you know, throwing them. And Canelo actually kind of was coasting a little bit in round two, you know, kind of collecting himself, you know, not being as aggressive. And, of course, he finished him in round three.
Right.
I think round three, when he knocked down Kirkland with that uppercut, the fight should have been stopped.
Exactly. I said the same thing. Yeah.
And from that point forward, the damage that he took, I don't know why. Maybe I'm getting a little mellow as I get older or something, but I was thinking about Jermaine Taylor, because I bet you the damage that he took after that uppercut, I mean, it was probably exponential. I mean, that was
a hard shot.
That was brutal. I was expecting them to cut to a shot of Duke on the side of the corner, like,
throw
in the
towel.
I mean, that, it really kind of, you know, brought out the bleeding heart in me. And I think people, they let the fight go on because of the fact that the Mayweather-Pacquiao fight was a stinker, and Canelo really, I mean, his star power. Say what you want about, you know, the brutality of that fight, his star power just. Oof.
Yeah, that last punch that knocked him out.
Holy cow.
They called it a straight. To me, it looked more of a straight hook. It's like a hybrid between a straight and a hook, and that is one of the hardest shots I've seen in a while. Underneath the heavy, you know, the heavyweight division.
I mean, like, I'm a fan of good fights. I'm a fan of great knockouts. Ricky Hatton versus Pacquiao. That's an example of a great knockout. This, I felt like someone in the Coliseum waiting for someone to be slaughtered. I mean, this.
If he dies, he does.
Well,
yeah.
You know, learn a little bit about Kirkland.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was the only way he can go.
Right.
I mean, because if anything else would have happened, him stopped too soon, he would have been disappointed with his corner. So sometimes knowing the character of the fighter, you got to allow them to do what they do supposedly best, and that's go out on your back sometimes.
Right.
You know?
And you know, he was never really, at least I'll see what y'all think. He never really was out of it. He was hurt.
Until he got hit that last.
Yeah, well, that last time.
Yeah. But no questions.
The two previous knockdowns.
Yeah.
He never was out of it. He was hurt.
Yeah.
But even when he got back up, he was straight. But he was just slow because he was out of gas. What do you think?
From the outside looking in, it looked like this should have been stopped sooner.
Yeah, right.
As a trainer myself, I would have let it go. I'm sorry. I mean, because I don't want to be questioned with the fact that why did you stop it? You know, so sometime when a guy's tough and he's gritty, he's edgy, you got to let him sometime find out the hard way.
And that's interesting. It's a different philosophies. I mean, I don't know how, you know, the rookie trainer obviously was thinking that way too. But I felt like the Angulo-Kirkland fight was a different story because, obviously, you know, Angulo and Canelo, they're two different caliber type fighters. But in this situation, I felt like after the first knockdown, he didn't really have a chance the way he did against Angulo. Mm-hmm. I think as a trainer, you got to get a feel for that. But, you know, that's me. Everyone's different. You know, that's just the feeling that I had going in.
Well, with the Angulo fight, he had a world-class corner.
Right.
And with the Kirkland fight, he had an amateur corner.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the difference.
That's a common denominator. Yeah. You can't argue with that.
Yeah. He's a completely different fighter without Ann Wolf in his corner.
And most fighters are.
Yeah.
I mean, because fighting is about creatures of habit. You become into the habit of the voice and the process.
Mm-hmm.
And when you step away from that, some guys can make those adjustments if they do it in an adequate amount of time. Most fighters can't. You know, because you become used to a process that suddenly and abruptly, in this case, changed, so it threw everything off,
right.
You know, evidently so.
Now, where does Canelo, first of all, go from here? What's next?
Canelo has a lot of options. I mean, the world is his oyster right now.
Mm-hmm.
He can, I think he's looking at Cotto right now. I think that's the next huge fight in boxing, just from a number standpoint, a star power standpoint. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Triple G is an option for any of these guys, and an unwelcome option right now. Everyone wants to fight him in the future.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hopefully, when he gets a little older. But I think everyone's looking at Cotto and Canelo. I think that would be a fantastic fight, another Puerto Rico versus Mexico fight. And we'll see what happens. These guys are kind of involved in this triangle right now. You know, we got Daniel Gill and Cotto fighting mm-hmm. soon. Triple G fighting Monroe.
Monroe tonight, as a matter of fact.
Absolutely. I think they're all kind of looking at each other.
Right. Now that's a perfect. So let me ask you real quickly, champ. As a former fighter, how do you rebound from that? You ain't never got knocked out like that. You never got knocked out. But rebounding from a loss in general, how do you come back?
You speaking of Kirkland?
Yeah.
He has to put his house back in order. Mm-hmm. I mean, the two losses he had, his house was out of order, meaning he was minus hand wolf. So he has to maybe reconsider some adjustments that was maybe ill-made and go back to what got him where he was.
That's it.
You know, if he don't do that, I think we will continue to see the same thing and it might get a little worse. You know, I think he's starting, that fight started to put him on the downside of his career. Mm-hmm. So he's going to have to put the one person that can put him together and put him out there and show a good performance. I think that's his only option.
Okay. Do you think that that will happen?
Depends on what happened behind the scenes. She seemed to be pretty compassionate about his loss. So that may bring them back together and negotiate some terms that may have fell apart. And put it back together. I mean, she doesn't have, I don't think anybody else right now that she's working with of a status of a Kirkland.
Right.
So it would be to her best interest as well as a trainer to get a pretty much developed fighter that has some pedigree and get back on the scene, you know. So for his, it would be to the both of their best interest to come back together.
And he only has two losses on his record. At the end of the day, he's an exciting fighter.
Yeah.
His promoter, 50 Cent, wants him to be back. With Ann Wolf, actually.
Right. Now,
50 Cent.
Yeah. That's a whole nother animal.
Not doing well right now.
That's a whole nother animal. So, yeah. So now we want to talk a little bit about segueing into the Triple G and Willie Monroe fight, which is tonight, as a matter of fact. Champ, talk to me about that fight.
Might see what you saw last week.
Uh-oh. Triple G don't destroy him like that?
Triple V has the tremendous punching power, great ring skills, ability. And he's a great boxer, you know. And I think the kid on Monroe is limited.
He's only had 25.
Who is Monroe?
Yeah, he's only had 25.
What has he done?
Yeah.
You know, so he's on the big stage, and the big stage by itself mm-hmm. is a big hill to conquer. So you might see a 3-4, at best, 6-round fight. And I think Kirk is going to go out there and do what he – I mean, Triple G is going to go out there and do what he do, set him up, pick his punches, and finish him when he gets ready.
Okay.
You know? That's unfortunate, but we won't see a great fight. Okay. When you have heard of one guy and haven't heard of the other guy,
yeah, I'm
every
not
now and again, you know, you might get something great, but most of the time it's going to be as it's presented, you know, one-sided fight.
Right. Yeah. What do you think, Tula?
I heard on a podcast that Golovkin wanted to use this fight as a measurement to show that he can fight against all styles. Obviously, Willie Monroe is a slick fighter.
So. Southpaw.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Southpaw.
Yeah, always a challenge.
Not a threat to really knock him out. Golovkin, he has 6 knockouts and 19 wins.
Right.
We'll see. I think this is more of another showcase for Golovkin to show footwork and that he can close off the ring against, perhaps a slick southpaw.
And nobody will fight him.
And that's another.
That's the problem.
Nobody want none of that now.
Nobody want to fight him.
I haven't seen Monroe fight.
Yeah.
But I've seen Triple G fight, and they don't want none of that right now.
And you might not see Monroe fight tonight, too.
The hardest.
An interesting thing is, on Boxing Scene, I was reading that Golovkin, who has underrated footwork and skills, he was saying he could fight like he was talking about Mayweather. He could fight like him, but he's just really a man of the people. He just likes the action, big drama show.
Right. Well, we got to take a break, so we thank the champ for joining us. We'll be right back.
Rolling.
This is Richard Walker, the great sports Morpheus. And thanks.
I like funny because Mr. Still rolling.
Okay. This is Richard Walker, the great sports Morpheus. And make sure that you check out the Voice of Diversity.
The Voice of Diversity.
Where diversity finds its voice. I could say something easier, Coach Leah. Remember all that.
Houston, Texas practice bubble where you got over. Last year they had a. For the College Football Coach of the Year.
Hi, this is Mike Tula with Bring the Pain Sports. We're here at the 2015 Shell Houston Open. This is the final day of the tournament. As you all know, this year's tournament, Matt Jones already being cut. Matt Kuchar holding in there with -3 today. Likely not going to make the top.
In the NCAA Basketball South Regional Championship game, Coach K and his Blue Blue Devils playing sports, and we're still coming to you from NRG Stadium here in Houston, Texas, where Coach K and his Blue Blue Devils captured another Hey folks, Mitchell Brocker, Bring the Pain Sports, and we're still coming to you from NRG Stadium here in Houston, Texas, and the NCAA Basketball South Regional Championship game. Coach K and his Blue Dude.
Duke Blue Devils, not Blue Dude Devils. You see that? Oh man.
I don't know, dog. Duke Blue Devils. Oh man. And I knocked my intro out in one take. And now I can't say Duke Blue Devils. I can say it when the camera ain't rolling. That's because I really don't like Duke. I really don't like Duke. So my tongue automatically shuts down when it gets ready to come out.
That's because you're like a Gonzaga player at the free throw line when it matters.
Ooh. Hey folks, Mitchell Brocker, Bring the Pain Sports, and we're coming to you still from NRG Stadium here in Houston, Texas, and the NCAA Basketball South Regional Championship game. Coach K and his Blue Dude. Okay,
all right.
Oh shit. Coach K and his Blue.
You know I'm gonna make one hell of a
blooper
reel about this, right? You
do
understand that, right?
It's the same word every time.
All right.
Regional championship game where Coach K and his Duke Blue Devils took home the South Region championship by defeat. All right.
For us, this really true. For my friends, y'all ain't seen nothing. Just wait till we get through because we bad. Jump on it.
Hey folks, Mitchell Brock, Hall of Fame football player and BTP Sports Sideline to Sideline host. We're here in Super Bowl 49. Hey folks, Minor League Football Hall of Famer and host of BTP Sports Sideline to Sideline, Mitchell Brock, coming to you from Glendale, Arizona, home of this dog walking right to my shot. What's up, bro? we have to put that on. That's classic. Yo quiero Taco Bell. And you hungry. It's something wrong with you. Like all them homeless people begging, all that free pizza and stuff. We good?
One over, and the second playoff was between J.B. Holmes and the winner, Cut. Mike Tula here with Bring the Pain Sports. We just finished watching the 2015 Shell Houston Open. It was another exciting finish. As the 2004 Shell Houston Open, this one ended in a playoff as well, only this time it was a three-way tie between Charles Johnson and Johnson Wagner. Cut.
Go, Gary.
We're the directors of this group. And you are under our command.
Hey folks, this is Richard Walker, the Great Sports Morpheus, and you are watching Bring the Pain Sports right here on Afrocentric Network, Point Temple. Get out of the end.
Hey folks, and welcome back. Rejoining us, we got Mr. Damian Jolivet. Once again, we'd like to thank the champ for joining us here to talk about some boxing. So now, NBA playoffs. Is what, look at Tula smiling. He smiled about basketball and boxing like we do about football.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, and of course, we'll have Coach Leah chiming in for us here with this basketball segment because she is the gym rat diva, of course. So, I'd like to first of all thank the Los Angeles Clippers for completely foobarring my show today.
See, I was going to come in and we were going to do the conference championship previews, but no, they want to go to game seven. So we only got one conference preview to do today, and that's the Eastern Conference, which is already set. We got the one versus two. Number one, Atlanta Hawks. Number two, Cleveland Cavs. Ain't going to lie. Ain't what I saw in the Eastern Conference Finals. Tula, I know you don't put much stock into it now, but Atlanta won 3 out of 4 games in the regular season. What do you think about this series?
Well, to backtrack, we can talk about the Western Conference. It's going to be the Clippers and the who else is in the conference?
I don't know. You tell me.
And Golden State. My
okay.
It's a case of Saturday.
How you figure the team that already clinched?
Oh, hey, whatever. Hey, but Atlanta and Cleveland, you got to go with experience. You got to go with LeBron James. It's a constant issue. No one can guard him again on Atlanta. But, you know, crazier things have happened. It depends on injuries. Is Kyrie Irving going to stay injured? Is Shumpert going to keep playing at the level he's playing? He's really stepping up.
He is.
And J.R. Smith just needs to have one or two good games, and we'll see what happens. But I like Cleveland in this series. Sometimes you got to go with the obvious choice, and it's obvious for a reason.
Yeah, and I'll tell you my wild card with this series. Everybody knows LeBron and J.R. Smith, who also been stepping up. Tristan Thompson has really been – when Kevin Love went down, we like, oh, there it is, no more low post presence. But Tristan Thompson has really been balling. Jalvet, talk to me about this series.
Well, I agree with Tula what he says. You have to go with Cleveland and the experience to go along with it that LeBron James has. The good thing about it, even though they have had some injuries to Kyrie Irving and LeBron James with his ankle, but they do have some time to heal. I'm pretty sure they're sleeping in hyperbaric chambers.
Yeah,
hyperbaric chambers, getting that extra oxygen in their blood so that they can get ready to go. And I thought the same thing. When Kevin Love went down, I was like, well, you know, it's a wrap now. Mm-hmm. But, however, the big story was not – or is LeBron James and Kevin Love getting along in the locker room like I was saying last month?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, now it is how they are consistently still playing together as a team and still winning night in and night out. It's more struggles. It's a little harder. But, hey, when you have LeBron James, the best player on the planet as of right now, mm-hmm. you know, you always have a chance.
Yeah.
And
you know,
Timothy Mozgov also.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. That's the John Paxson of this team.
Oh, yeah.
Just come through in it. Now, Leah, you with me?
I'm with you.
You with me. Okay. Talk to me about this series.
Okay. What can I say? Let me be clear. We're talking about the Rockets and Clippers series, correct?
No, we're talking about Cleveland and Atlanta.
Oh, we've already switched. Okay. I'm sorry. We're delayed just a tad. So, okay. We're talking about the Cleveland series against Atlanta?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, goodness. I want to go with Cleveland, and I'll tell you why. And I talked about this a little bit earlier this week on my show. I really feel like LeBron James, who should have been a bigger part of the MVP discussion because of so many of the intangible things that he brings to the table, with how he knows how to manage the team, and he's on the court with them. There's something to be said about that team chemistry when it comes to being able to win championships. And so, I mean, there's no question that he's brought Cleveland this far and he brought Miami this far in the same manner. And so I just don't feel like Atlanta has a LeBron James type of star on their team that's going to be able to carry them all the way through the series. So I really do think that Cleveland will get to the Eastern Conference Finals.
Now, you basically took my sentiment, which was star power. Atlanta, I mean, they got Teague and they got, you know, the young guys that they got coming up.
Carroll's been stepping up.
Millsap has really, Horford, yeah.
They got a good team, man.
Yeah, they're a better team, so to speak, but I just think the star power of Cleveland will take over the series. Now, I will also tell you this. LeBron took that Cleveland team, he took to the finals in, what was that, 02, 03, when they got beat by the Spurs? I know you know.
No, that was 05.
05.
Okay.
05, when they got swept by the Spurs. That team, he could have took four of us out of here.
07.
Yeah, and because 05, we went.
It was the Nets.
Y'all beat us in the finals. Y'all got lucky. But he's got a way better surrounding cast this time around in Cleveland than he had that year.
Well, that's not saying much, but...
True.
Yes, they do, and really, the MVP should be at the end of the postseason, I'm telling you guys.
Because, agree, agree.
You got James Harden crying about not winning MVP, going 5 of 20 in the closeout game. The only reason why there's a Game 7 is because he was on the bench. And the Rockets and Corey Brewer and
shots fired,
you know, go off. LeBron James, this team really has constructed only been together since after the All-Star break because of the trade with the New York Knicks, mm-hmm. and then Kevin Love getting injured. And there's games where LeBron's, you know, scoring the bulk of the points. But there's always games where he's dishing out assists. He's setting people up. He's throwing alley-oops to Timothy Mozgov. He's making his players and his teammates better.
He is.
And I don't know. It's an obvious choice. Stephen Curry, obviously, you know, he deserves it.
Can't argue it, yeah.
Can't argue with it. But LeBron James is a better player, best player in the NBA, makes his team better. And I cannot agree more with Ms. Frazier right there.
Right. So we're all in concurrence that Cleveland is going to win this series. I'd say 5 or 6.
I say 6. You know, 6. Kudos to Atlanta. I didn't think they'd make it this
Me far. Neither. I ain't going to lie. I thought you got something, Joe?
I'm going 5.
You going Cleveland 5?
I'm going 5. Cleveland 5.
Yeah, I thought, I ain't going to lie, I thought that Washington, I think losing John Wall, you know, is what killed Washington for that game.
Well, and they didn't count the Paul Pierce buzzer beater.
Oh, yeah. That was insane. So I said, you know, I posted on my Facebook. So you mean tell me I jumped out of my chair and yelled like that and made my neighbors think I was crazy all for nothing? I think made that shot, like, you know, but yeah, so we're all going to go Cleveland. Now, the Western Conference is going to be a little bit of a open-ended sort of thing because we don't know who it is yet. We got the Warriors on one side, which is number one seed, and you've got the Rockets, which the number two seed, and the Clippers, who are playing tomorrow, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Or it'll be today by the time y'all see this, for the right to go to the Western Conference Finals. Jalavet, talk to me about this series as a whole and about tomorrow's game.
Well, this series as a whole, let's see, Steph Curry, what can you say? He's been Steph Curry as far as with the Warriors and them beating the Memphis Grizzlies last night. And I tweeted this out to Rich last night. I said, man, this dude has mastered the physics of shooting the basketball with that three-quarter shot buzzer beater at the end, even though it was supposed to probably be a foul and things of that nature. But he has mastered the physics of shooting a pro at all levels. Now, the Rockets and Clippers game, you know, I look at this game from a totally different perspective for the fact that I see Matt Barnes playing sometimes, but he kind of plays like a Rodman, you know, kind of getting underneath Dwight Howard's skin. Mm-hmm. You know, Rodman, he wouldn't talk to you, but he would nudge you and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. But Matt Barnes, he talks a whole lot.
He's Gary Payton.
Yeah, basically. And, you know, James Harden sat the bench, you know, the whole fourth quarter last game and things of that
like
nature.
Like Tula said, that's why they won.
Yeah, that's why they won. But, I mean, the game is going to be here. So the Rockets do have, I don't believe in home court advantage, but people are going to say they have the home court advantage and things of that nature. Hey, look, I'd much rather play on the road, me personally.
No distractions. All you got to worry about is the game.
Yeah, all you have to worry about is the
you
game.
You got to worry about tickets. You ain't got to worry about your wife and your kids and your family.
Exactly.
All you got to do is get up, go eat, go to the stadium, play.
Right.
That's it.
But this is the deal. If they can get going and keep and score inside the post the way they've been doing, then they should win the game, and we should see a Rockets-Warriors Western Conference Finals, and that would be a perfect match between the 1 and 2 seeds.
Tula?
The Rockets didn't necessarily win Game 6. They really got it handed to them by the Clippers. Clippers stopped going to Blake Griffin.
They did.
They gave that game away, essentially. I think they're battle-tested. They probably they haven't been in this position before. They beat the San Antonio Spurs. Actually, the Spurs gave them that series, too, at the end, but I'm not going to go into that. They beat the Spurs.
How do the Spurs wind up on every segment of this show?
Because they're a very relevant team in the NBA. And they are a barometer by which to judge the Clippers' psyche.
This is true.
They kind of let up a little bit in the series, but they will. The Clippers starting five is better than the Rockets starting five.
Clearly.
You're not going to see Josh Smith stepping back, you know, shooting these fadeaway threes and them dropping in.
We're not making them anyway, yeah.
Clippers are the better team, clearly, and they should wrap it up on Game 7.
Well, they should have wrapped it up in Game 5.
Well, Game 7.
On the quiet as kept, this could have been a sweep. The Rockets were one big quarter in game, I think it was 3-2 away from getting swept out the building.
Do you trust the Rockets to win Game 7?
I do. And I'm going to I don't trust the Rockets. I'm going to tell you what I trust. I trust momentum. And I trust up here. I trust the fact that I think that the Clippers lost their heart in Game 6. I think the Clippers lost their heart.
It's going to be very hard for the Clippers to win it because the fact that this is a back-to-back seven-game series for the Clippers.
I don't buy much into that. I mean,
Chris Paul took game one.
When you're playing every other day, hey, look, that stuff takes a pounding on your body.
It does, but I just believe that the momentum that the Rockets go into the game with and the – I just felt like the Clippers lost their heart. That's the best way I can put it. I just felt like they were done after six.
They're not going to lose focus the way they did in game six come game seven.
That's just that's so you got the Clippers tomorrow.
Yes, they should win easily.
I'm going to take the Rockets just because.
get a little bit of drama on it.
It doesn't matter to me who win this game, but I'm going to take the Rockets just due to the fact that it's a home
game. I'm like you. I don't have a horse in the race, so I have no reason to say, oh, I want them to win. I don't care who wins. My team didn't make the playoffs, but I just think that the Rockets will get it done at home. Leah, real quickly, who you think is going to win this series or this game in series?
I've got to go with the Clippers. I'm a huge Doc Rivers fan. I'm a huge DeAndre Jordan fan. Even though Kevin McHale is my homeboy and love him to death, named my eldest child after him. However, I just love how Doc Rivers is the player's coach. Kevin is somewhat as well, but he has reinvigorated this Clipper team, and I really feel like that was a blip, and they're just going to ride this all the way out.
Right. Well, we got to take a break, as you just heard, so we'll be right back.
It's Andy Kalou from In the Trenches on Sports Talk 790. When I talk sports, I bring the pain with the BDP guys.
Hey, folks, and welcome back. So we got the NBA and boxing and other stuff out of the way. So now it's time to do what we really do here, and that's talk football. Everybody knows what's going on with the Patriots and the Tom Brady Deflategate situation. We're not going to talk really about Deflategate because we've already talked about that. We're going to talk about, in general, the overall legacy of the Patriots dynasty is what people are calling him. We know what happened with Deflategate. Tom Brady got a 4-game suspension. Tula, talk to me about this 4-game suspension. They're appealing, of course. Do you think that this suspension is going to stand?
No. I mean, they usually don't, right? I mean, the suspensions, it's almost like they give it out 4 games because they anticipate, you know, maybe it's really going to be 2-3 games later on down the line. Who knows? But it's Tom Brady. We've never seen the poster boy, poster child get suspended. So I got to give him the benefit of the doubt, say maybe he's going to cut it down. It's definitely not going to be 4 games. I don't see it.
So you think that they kind of overcompensate because they anticipate the appeal and then it's going to get dropped anyway?
That's just me being the skeptical self that I am.
It usually happens that way, though. Yeah. Usually appeals, they usually win. And they normally get it just like the Ray Rice thing, you know, even though that wind up being a whole different animal.
When was the last time a suspension actually stood for the game? Obviously, not the obvious cases, but, you know, I don't remember the last time the actual suspension stood for the X amount of games that it was supposed to stand.
I think the Aaron Hernandez suspension is going to stand for a little while. Aaron Hernandez, I think that one's going to stand for a little bit.
Obvious choice. Yeah. I had that preposition for a reason.
Yeah. But I already had that joke prepared, so I wasn't going to waste it just because you prefaced it.
Oh, you should have told me. I would have said easier softball.
Yeah, I got you. Yeah. So what do you think?
Well, the Patriots, is the dynasty tainted? It just depends on which way you look at it. You know, Patriot haters, they're going to say, it's been tainted. You know, they're going to always – it's like putting that little asterisk against Barry Bonds. Because you cheated. But at the same time, football, we all know, you always push the envelope. You know, there's something, everybody's going to always do something illegal. You know, hey, look, Tom Brady likes his ball a little flat. Mm. You know, Aaron Rodgers likes his a little bit more inflated. So you can say the Green Bay Packers cheat because they inflate the balls a little bit more because Aaron Rodgers likes his ball a lot more inflated.
Right.
So, is it tainted in media eyes and the way it's being put out there? Yes. But actually, hey, look, they're just doing what football
everybody
is known
does.
For.
Yeah. I don't.
Now, I don't know if everybody goes as far as going on and catching people's signals. Now, during the game, yes. But
that's
practices and stuff, no.
That's a whole different ballgame. Yeah. Now, as far as the footballs, every quarterback I was a center, so I touched the ball every play. Every quarterback I've ever played with had a preference as to how he liked the football. This is the way I saw the Tom Brady thing going. He's warming up. Oh, man, it's too much air in that ball. Take some air out that ball. How's that? Yeah, that's better. I don't think they had a meter saying, okay, take 2 pounds of pressure out of that ball. I think they just played around with it until it felt the way Brady wanted it to feel. Because all quarterbacks do that.
I mean, right? you had Brad Johnson coming out, right. Jeff Blake coming out. I don't know how many other quarterbacks coming out.
Kurt Warner.
No one's complaining about
that. Warren
Moon. Warren Moon. Oh, yeah.
Warren Moon was the most meticulous guy.
And let me tell you something. If people think that actually had an outcome of the game, especially against the Colts, Andrew Luck had a bigger outcome of that game than deflated balls, because I don't know how many interceptions he returned for touchdowns.
Exactly.
In that game. That is, to me, this is a non-issue. People in the media, mainstream media, who want to be 2020 48-hour reporters, they got this because it's a direct, you know, black and white. Oh, he cheated. It's a, so then they can create a narrative,
right.
Cast a huge, you know, shadow of doubt on success, and it's a classic setup. To me, no big deal.
No, I mean, let's talk about the AFC Championship game. LeGarrette Blount had 25 carries for like 130 something yards.
Goodness.
Right.
Three touchdowns, two, I remember.
What did it have to do with the footballs?
Nothing.
Not a thing.
The Colts defense just couldn't tackle.
No, and like.
Well, they also draw. I know they make a point that they hadn't fumbled as much. They had the least amount of fumbles for X amount of years, and they're trying to make a direct correlation to deflating. That's then if you're using facts to argue, that's one thing. But you know, at the same time, you got to if you give other teams the same amount of no big deal.
No, I mean, let's talk about the AFC Championship game. LeGarrette Blount had 25 carries for like 130-something yards.
Goodness.
Right.
Three touchdowns, two, I remember.
What did it have to do with the footballs?
Nothing.
Not a thing.
The Colts defense just couldn't tackle.
No, and like.
Well, they also draw. I know they make a point that they hadn't fumbled as much. They had the least amount of fumbles for X amount of years, and they're trying to make a direct correlation to deflating. That's then if you're using facts to argue, that's one thing. But you know, at the same time, you got to if you give other teams the same amount of deflation in their balls, they still have to execute and make plays.
Every one of us on this panel played a position where we handled the football. You were a DB, you were a wide receiver, I was a center. It is actually more difficult to handle a ball with less air in it, at least from my experience.
Yeah.
It's harder to hold a ball with less air than to carry it than it is with more air, in my experience.
Oh, easier to catch with the softer one, but yeah, I mean it's such a non-issue.
It is so minor. It shouldn't even be a story. Look, you deflated a whole bunch of air out of the balls, or a little bit over the NFL standards. Hey, look, we'll find you this going on, and we'll just check the balls.
And not just that, they're taking draft picks.
Oh yeah,
there's a fine. I mean, the draft picks, I definitely don't agree with that.
I mean,
you're punching the whole organization now for what a couple of people did. A couple of people being Brady, the ball boy.
I think that's reparations for Spygate and all the other stuff. They say, oh, we finally got a reason to come down on him. Let's just do it now so people get off our backs.
Kind of like OJ.
Yeah,
okay, you got away the first time, but
we got to prove that we're not in cahoots with Robert Kraft and all that.
Well, you know Robert Kraft and Goodell, that's his boy.
Yeah.
That's his man's right there.
That's why it's politics.
It's all politics. So now let's talk a little bit about Spygate. Mm-hmm. Like you brought it up a little bit. 2002, when they played their first Super Bowl, when they played the Rams, they were accused of videotaping the Rams walkthrough.
Right.
How do you feel about that?
Well, in that case, Spygate should have been handled a lot harsher than what it was, because you're actually going through and you're seeing game plans and game preparations to where you can actually make plays to counter every single thing that they're doing. You know, it's already hard enough to win football games because you do actually have to trade film and scout and study. Now that they have the fact that they actually went and recorded it, it's like, okay, this is a no-brainer. You know, we see the signals, we see the calls. So now this is, I have the perfect play drawn up to beat that.
I keep thinking, every time I hear that, I think about that Ty Law interception.
Yes.
It's like he knew that play was coming. He was, oh, here it come. boom.
And not even just that team, but a lot of other teams that mm-hmm. they played, even the years that they didn't win the Super Bowl championships, they were like, man, it's like the Patriots, they knew exactly
what we were doing.
They knew the shifts, they knew the signals, they knew everything about us.
And that's
how to combat it.
And that was the other thing they got caught doing is, and that was 07 mm-hmm. when they got caught recording the Jets' defensive signals.
Right.
Now, I'll go back to you as a DB. Mm-hmm. How big of a difference did that make?
That makes a huge difference. Mm-hmm. Because now, if you have my signal, you know where the void is in the defense. Mm-hmm. You know where the blitz is coming from. And I don't care how smart of a quarterback, you could be as smart as Andrew Luck, grading like a 99 coming out and being the first round, being the first overall draft pick. If you know exactly where the blitz is coming from, you're going to throw to that void. And even you don't even have to throw to the void. You can also adjust your routes because Absolutely. Your routes can be totally different. Mm-hmm. But if you know if you know you're running a slant flat concept, mm-hmm. you can automatically change to the post curl concept
right.
and beat it because you know which coverage how it rolls.
That's right.
Because you know everything in NFL or in football from college and above defensively is shown as one way. You know, you can show a two high safety, but you roll in the one. But if you already know that pre-snap and you know about a signal, you already know where you're going. You know where the safety is void in that. You know where the strength is called and how they play it. So now you have an extra advantage. And, of course, you're going to put 50 on me.
I'll give you the perfect example of what you just said. One of the most, I'm not going to say tainted, but one of the most unimpressive Super Bowls to me was when Tampa Bay beat the Raiders. Mm-hmm. Because John Gruden... Whew. Would they have like 6 picks that game? And like 3 of them went to the house?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you should have. I mean, that was your defense they were running. You went from the Raiders and went to Tampa, and he knew exactly what Callahan was doing the whole game.
Right.
It's kind of the same.
They didn't change it.
Yes. Yeah, I guess a lot of that was on Callahan for not changing it.
Right.
But at the same time, if you're in somebody's huddle or you're in their playbook, obviously you have an unfair advantage, right?
It almost seems like there are – pre-game adjustments being made before the game even starts. Mm-hmm. So you're already mm-hmm. going into that. And now I'm thinking of all those interceptions. Oh, Teddy Bruschi, he was in the right place at the right time. You know, everyone's in the right place at the right time. They knew what was coming.
Exactly.
Apparently. And I think this is why everyone's making a big deal about Deflategate, because that, you know, Spygate, much bigger deal. It has a direct outcome, you know, a direct effect of the outcome of the game, as mm-hmm. Damon just pointed out. More so than a deflated ball.
Exactly. You took the words out of my mouth. I would have rather seen a harsh punishment for Spygate than Deflategate, because that, like you said, direct impact. If you know what I'm doing, it don't matter how good I am, if you know what I'm doing.
Right.
Yeah,
exactly.
You know, so in closing, are the Super Bowls tainted? What was it, 5?
Oh.
They've won 5.
Yeah,
they've won 7. Been to 6. Won 4. I'm sorry. They won 4 out of 6. Are they tainted?
A couple of them, I would believe, are tainted.
What about this year?
This year, I wouldn't say this year because it's just a deflated ball.
But the Spygate wins. The Spygate.
I mean, because you got to think about it. The Patriots, when they started off this year, they started off horrible.
The first year they got caught doing it is the first year they won the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Imagine that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So those are tainted, but Deflategate or not?
Okay. Right.
Okay.
I can understand why you say it would be, but I don't think so.
What? Which one?
That it would be tainted. I don't think it is, but I can definitely see how you can argue that.
Spygate?
Yes.
So you don't think Spygate is?
It's something, but I just to say that you know their Super Bowls don't matter. They got tainted. Definitely cast a little bit of a shadow, mm-hmm. but you still got to give it to them. Although I think of Marcellus Wiley when he was he mentioned their podcast. He's like, God, they're not better than us. How did they beat us? So I can definitely see the argument for that, but I'm not gonna. You know, that's a lot of.
Yeah. All coaches cheat. That Belichick cheats a little bit more than others.
And better.
He's
a
Sith Lord cheat.
Yeah,
he gets away.
Yeah, I agree. I think that the Deflategate Super Bowl that had nothing to do with it. The Spygate ones. Like you said, I wouldn't say they're tainted, but there is a bit of a shadow. So that's that with that, folks. But, hey, we got to go. So we definitely appreciate you guys joining us. And we'll see you next time. It's Mitchell Brock of Brina Payne Sports. Catch you next time.